some work that I've been doing with some collaborators in the United States looking at immigration policy. And not looking at immigration policy, and I should acknowledge my collaborators first, Deborah Schilkow from Tufts University, who's a political scientist, Yen Ho at University of California, Los Angeles, who is a social psychologist, and John DeVideo at Yale, who also a social psychologist. And the four of us came together through some organizing events that the Russell Sage Foundation did in New York to try to get people to work across disciplinary lines, across methodological lines, to examine topics related to immigration, related to what Russell Sage was calling at the time cultural contact, that is the, you know, essentially contact between people from different ethnic and racial groups, and to see if we could establish some collaborations. And we did just that. And the four of us had a shared interest in immigration policy and a shared interest in the way in which variation in immigration policy affects individuals in a social psychological sense. And we were particularly interested not so much in immigration policy at the federal level, that is, immigration policy that regulates who can come in, who has to go, citizenship, visas, et cetera, but really how sub-federal jurisdictions, states, counties, cities were playing the immigration policy game and the way in which variation in that immigration policy game was shaping the lives of the people who live under those jurisdictions. So one of the motivations for this research comes from a couple of basic observations. One is that the sheer number of immigration policies taking place at the sub-federal level has exploded, and exploded particularly in the first decade, even right up to the present of the 21st century. This has come from the National Conference of State Legislatures, and it just shows the number of state-level immigration policies in any given year. I'm going to get my There used to be a lot more. That's right. Yeah. And so there is sort of a trend in what one might call welcoming and unwelcoming sub-federal immigration policies. Now we're moving to the, we're still at the state level here, and this comes from the Immigration Climate Index. A couple of economists at Baylor, who I think are married, but I'm not sure. Fam. And they have created an index that looks at how welcoming a set of immigration policies are at the state level. This index combines some coding that they've done on whether an immigration policy is neutral, welcoming, or unwelcoming, and then they kind of normalize it looking at the amount of geography that particular policy covers and then also the number of people who would fall under it. And they've created this index, and what the index shows here, looking at when they started keeping track in 2005 up to the most current period for which they have data, which is 2017, is that there was this incredible, starting here at zero and neutral, the overwhelming trend in sub-federal immigration policies up until about 2012 was really unwelcoming. These were policies that restricted access to in-state tuition at colleges and universities, restricted access to state funding, implemented trespassing laws. Some counties implemented trespassing laws whereby if an undocumented immigrant was in a particular jurisdiction, the county could say that they were trespassing. Ordinances limiting the ability of renters to rent to people who were undocumented. 287G agreements, which is a lot, which is a portion of the immigration law that allows local and state police to cooperate, to actually get training from the federal from ICE, Immigration Customs Enforcement, to enforce immigration laws at a local level, overwhelmingly negative. And then there was this turn where the immigration laws became much more, I should say, overwhelmingly unwelcoming, where they became much more welcoming. And this comes from a paper where they're looking at the kind of trends in their immigration climate index post-Trump, and state, county, and municipal immigration policies actually become even more welcoming under Trump. So as the Trump administration has implemented more unwelcoming policies, states, counties, this kind of tells the same, this kind of tells the same picture, just kind of lining up the what they call negative and positive, what we call welcoming and unwelcoming loss together, and you get a sense of the same picture that, that in the most recent period going back to 2012, more positive or welcoming laws are outnumbering the unwelcoming. And of course, there have been some places that have stood as emblems of either welcoming or unwelcoming policies, and the state of Arizona, in no uncertain terms, anchors the unwelcoming end of the state-level policy spectrum. Arizona, going back to the early 2000s, introduced and passed through the legislative process, but also passed through through the electoral process, a series of unequivocally unwelcoming immigration policies. Some of those policies explicitly dealt with immigration, like taking away business licenses from businesses, that state-level business licenses from businesses that were found to have hired undocumented immigrants, from banning driver's licenses for undocumented immigrants, which are driver's licenses are granted at the state level, in-state tuition, requiring undocumented immigrants to pay out-of-state tuition, which is, tell me, and you can stop me at any time if any of this sounds bizarre. I'm assuming a certain level of knowledge, tuition at colleges and universities, state-level colleges and universities, just like public universities, I should say, that private universities can do whatever they want. And perhaps most famously, in 2010, the state of Arizona passed SB 1070, which was a law that did a number of things, perhaps the most prominent of which allowed state and local police to check the immigration status of people who they suspected of being undocumented. This is a so-called show me your papers provision of that law. Portions of the law were found to be unconstitutional. So Arizona, and I'll show you this in a second in kind of numerical terms, is unequivocally the most unwelcoming state in the United States when it comes to immigration policy. I want to bracket this off, and maybe we can talk about this in a second, just to talk about how things can change. A generation ago, California was unequivocally the most unwelcoming state for immigrants in the union. Obviously, you can feel free to disagree with that, I don't know, but okay. I agree. That's why I think Arizona is California 20 years ago. It's shifting. Maybe that's something to bracket. We'll talk about in a second. At the other end of the spectrum, but certainly sitting on the more welcoming side of the spectrum, is Arizona's eastern neighbor, New Mexico. New Mexico is a state that has, in some ways, and I'll show this in a second, similar demographics to Arizona. The racial and ethnic dynamics in Arizona are quite different for a variety of historical reasons, but nonetheless, New Mexico has been much more welcoming, and not only more welcoming, but a kind of early adopter of welcoming policies. You can go back to the 1980s when New Mexico declared itself a sanctuary state, mostly for Salvadoran refugees who were leaving civil war in El Salvador. But even into the 2000s, the state of New Mexico granted drivers, allowed driver's licenses for undocumented immigrants. If you're undocumented and you've gone to high school in New Mexico, you can get in-state tuition. You can get funding from the state to pay for state colleges and universities. Going back to its founding, its constitution is written in Spanish and English. It's a sense of cultural home for people who are Spanish speakers. The police in New Mexico have no 287G agreements. I'll show this in a second. State prisons do, but that's kind of, I'd say, rather uncontroversial. And to give you a kind of national picture of how welcoming or unwelcoming states are, I return to the Immigration Climate Index by FAM and FAM, and you see, for those of you maybe not so familiar with United States geography, this is Arizona. Here, unequivocally anchoring the unwelcoming end of the spectrum. Today, California is arguably the most welcoming state. And then you have New Mexico, which actually was more welcoming when they first started keeping track of the index, and I can explain if you're interested why it becomes slightly less welcoming, but still sits more in the middle, but sort of on the more welcoming end of the spectrum. And so my colleagues and I wanted to compare these two states in such a way that would allow us to understand understand how living in a unequivocally unwelcoming place, an unwelcoming climate, part of that is because of the state-level immigration policies, part of that is just the kind of more general social milieu, and living in a more welcoming place shapes the lives of people who live under those kind of policy conditions. Just to kind of allow you to see the differences and similarities between New Mexico and Arizona, I present this table which comes from the paper that I distributed. New Mexico has a much larger Hispanic Latino population. It's important to know the Latino population in New Mexico self-consciously is for some a quote-unquote Spanish population. There are large numbers of Latinos in New Mexico who trace their roots in that area of the country back to when Spain controlled that part of the United States and indeed identify themselves as Spanish. Nonetheless, there's been a relatively sizable influx of immigrants, mostly from Mexico, but not exclusively. New Mexico is a border state, although it has a much smaller border with Mexico than does Arizona, but nonetheless a border state. They have, you can compare the size of the white population. New Mexico has, New Mexico has a little bit smaller foreign-born population. If you look at the size of the unauthorized population, that is people, this is the proportion of the total population of states that's unauthorized, they're roughly equivalent. We chose these two states not only because of their neighbors, but because relative to any other combination of states that we could have compared, they look somewhat similar in a demographic sense. I can go into the ways that we tied ourselves in knots trying to figure out which comparisons were right and which comparisons we could actually handle in just kind of analytically. But I'll kind of race down here to the bottom where you can see differences in their state-level approaches to immigration policy in terms of driver's licenses, in-state tuition, in-state financial aid, 287G agreements, so-called show me your papers provision. And then there are these kind of more symbolic policies, like having English as the official language, limits on bilingual education. This is not to mention that the state of Arizona banned Mexican-American studies several years ago. So it has been a kind of deluge of anti-immigrant policy. So we wanted to compare these states and ask why, what is it like living in one of these very different immigration climates. I'm going to race through the kind of literature background and not actually dwell on this too much to get more of the findings. But I say here that there has been focus on these subfederal immigration policies taken up mostly by political scientists with the intent of explaining why some jurisdictions, some states, some counties, some cities have more welcoming policies and why others have unwelcoming policies. The perhaps not surprising bottom line is that partisanship matters a lot. Where Republicans dominate, you're much more likely to see unwelcoming policies. Pham and Pham argue that there's some role of domestic migration, that it's people moving from unwelcoming states to welcoming states and then making those states more unwelcoming. I'm actually a little bit dubious about that explanation. And then Abigail Williamson, who's a political scientist who did kind of this methods project, says that some of these localities lean more welcoming because they're taking their cues from the federal government pre-Trump, which has been either mostly kind of hands-off or welcoming, particularly in their services to refugees. Again, this is Trump is the caveat. And I think I should be congratulated because I've made it 14 minutes into this presentation about immigration policy in the United States, and I've just mentioned Donald Trump for the first time. So I think that's a victory. So there's a couple ways to think about how living in a particular immigration policy climate affects the individuals who live in these states. One is directly, and policies have an administrative function. They tell us what to do and what we can't do and punish us when we do the things we're not supposed to. But there is also a kind of indirect effect, a sort of policy feedback, and that is that policies don't just dictate our lives administratively, but they send us signals about who we are, who belongs, who doesn't, what we should believe. They frame our way of seeing the world, and we're kind of taking our cues from this notion of policy feedback. There's been some research, most ethnographic research, with this exception looking at birth weight in Arizona, looking at policy feedback among Latinos, but we actually want to push this a little bit further. So our intervention is one that we're interested in welcoming policies, following the observation that policies at the subfederal level have become much more welcoming. We wondered how that is having an effect on people. And then we also wanted to know about the non-targeted population. So most of the research on subfederal immigration policies has looked at the so-called targets, and if not explicitly, implicitly, those the especially the kind of anti-immigrant, unwelcoming policies have been mostly targeted at Latino immigrants, and even more specifically than that, Mexican immigrants. Not exclusively, there have been some kind of anti-Sharia law policies passed targeting Muslim immigrants, but mostly Latinos. But what about whites? If there is a sense that immigration policies can create a warmer welcome or a kind of offer a warm welcome or a cold fist to immigrants, what does that warm welcome or cold fist do to the people who are in the majority position, the people who one might argue if this is a zero-sum game are most positioned to benefit? So we focus here on Latinos and whites and Arizona and New Mexico, and in this overall project, we're writing a book right now. We published three articles based on this. We wanted to know, are state-level immigration policies associated with feelings of belonging for whites and Latinos? And here we turn to a survey, which I'll tell you about in a second. We also wanted to ask, do state-level immigration policies cause feelings of belonging among U.S.-born whites and Latinos? And here we have an embedded experiment, which I'll tell you about very briefly at the end. And finally, we wanted to ask, how do Latinos and whites come to their sense of belonging living in a particular state-level immigration policy climate? And we did in-depth interviews. I said at the outset that the Russell Sage Foundation wanted us to do interdisciplinary work. They wanted us to do multi-method work, and we've done that. And it's actually really hard to put all these things together, but we've done our best. So I'm going to focus here mostly on the survey findings and then try to explain them a little bit with some samples of interview quotes that we have. Our data comes from a survey that we fielded in February and March of 2016. So this is before the election of Donald Trump, but well into his candidacy. It's important to point that out. And we have roughly 500 Latinos and whites in each state. Among the whites, they're all born in the United States. Our Latino population is divided between those who are born in the United States and those who are born abroad. We use a combination of random and digit dialing, both landline and cell phone. And then between August 2017 and May 2019, we did 125 interviews in each of these states, in the states combined. We did 65 in Arizona and 60 in New Mexico, again, divided along the lines that, between U.S.-born whites and U.S. and foreign-born Latinos. So our findings. So in the survey, and really more generally, our outcome of interest is really state of residence. So and nativity. So does being born in the United States or being born abroad among Latinos shape feelings of belonging? That's actually not quite right. That's actually the independent variable. Of interest is more state residence and nativity. And then we use our in-depth interviews to explain the findings. And then in our experiment, we're mainly interested in political ideology and state. And I'll kind of walk you through that in a second. So one of the things we wanted to know is whether the people that we surveyed and interviewed had the same perception of the state climate that we had based on our reading of the policy and based on our reading of the Immigration Climate Index. And so we asked people directly whether they thought that their state was welcoming to immigrants, and it turns out that among the Latinos we surveyed, and this is also true among the whites, incidentally, but this is right here, I'm showing the folks for Latinos, that they overwhelmingly agree with the assessment that Arizona is unwelcoming and New Mexico is welcoming. And here you have, in the dotted lines, you have the U.S.-born population. The kind of grayish dotted line is the U.S. born in New Mexico, the solid gray line is the foreign born in New Mexico, and then the dark lines are for Arizona. So they agree with our assessment. And when we went in and we did in-depth interviews, we were interested in their kind of holistic assessment of whether their state was welcoming to immigrants. And what we found was that the in-depth interviews correspond with what we found in our survey data, and that in particular Arizona, policies were key. So that when our respondents, foreign-born and U.S.-born alike, were talking about whether their state was welcoming to immigrants, they honed in on policy, and not just policy, but particular individuals who kind of represented those policies. In New Mexico, and I'm not going to really read quotes from New Mexico, it was much more about culture, and Arizona being a sort of cultural home, particularly for Latino immigrants, partly because Spanish is widely spoken, partly because of the history. And then we suspect that policy has something to do with it, but that people are much more attuned, and there's good psychological research showing this, much more attuned to negative news than they are to positive news. So the negative aspects of policy, and welcoming policy, just register more prominently in Arizona than the more welcoming policies do in New Mexico for that reason. So just to give you an example of some of what we heard from our respondents in Arizona. This is a 29-year-old legal permanent resident from Mexico. She's a graduate student, and she talked about her perception of whether Arizona is welcoming to immigrants, and she said, I mean, we had Sheriff Arpaio, a sheriff however many effing years, and people are trying to get him off forever, whose main purpose is essentially to terrorize Latinos in our community, who had like a hotline you could call to let people know if you had undocumented people around. And then we have a bunch of propositions that came about, like in like 2000. We have a politician, state officials who are very proud of their anti-immigrant stance. You have a governor like Jan Brewer, who sucked and introduced SB 1070, which like obviously Arizona was known for a long time, and then lots of us, we still are. So this is a shitty place to be in a lot of ways. If you're a brown person, if you're an immigrant, every turn of the way, you know, that in terms of the state, people don't want you here. Actually, you don't have to be an immigrant, because show me your papers. A lot targeted people who look like they have the reason, suspicion to believe that they're undocumented. So if you look brown, automatically that might maybe meant that you're undocumented. So no, it's not even immigrants, as if you're not white. Oh, I do have some quotes from New Mexico. So this is the first time I've ever presented this publicly, so you should feel very honored. Very honored that you get to hear me kind of fumble through it, given it's the first time I present it publicly. So we do have some quotes from New Mexico, and there is a way in which people pick up on policy, but it's in a much vaguer sense. It's policy sort of wrapped up in a kind of vague sense of the state as being a welfare place. There's a quote from a woman who is a retail clerk living under temporary protective status from El Salvador, and she said, and this is translated from Spanish, the translation is not perfect, but if there were like other states, this has to do a lot with immigrants, maybe it is, but here in New Mexico, I do not feel that way. I feel more protected, that the laws are more flexible with us, because there are many organizations that support us and others that kick us out, like the governor. But from there, I feel good, I feel safe. She's referring to Susana Martinez, who was the previous governor of New Mexico, who was a Republican, the daughter of Mexican immigrants, and tried to kind of repeal some of the more pro-immigrant policies, mostly without success. The governor of New Mexico, yeah, there's a new governor who is also Latina, who is a Democrat and a pro-immigrant. And it wasn't just that when our respondents in New Mexico, our Latino respondents, and our white respondents for that matter, were making sense of the degree to which New Mexico was welcome, they often used Arizona as a foil without our prompting. We didn't ask people to compare New Mexico and Arizona. We asked about their own state. And when they were trying to assess how welcoming New Mexico was, if policies were very vague, they seemed to become more specific when they could compare the state of belonging in Arizona and New Mexico. So we actually responded who we interviewed in Arizona who had moved 2 years prior and grown up in New Mexico, moved 2 years prior to Arizona, and talked about the policies in Arizona as a factor, or at least a consideration, when she moved to the state. She said, so I was aware of the policies by Jan Brewer, the former governor. I knew about Sheriff Joe Arpaio. I knew about SB 1060. It is 1060? She got the name of the policy wrong. I knew about, you know, just a lot of crime was kind of scapegoated against Latinos. It's been blaming them for a lot, drug trade. And so part of my hesitation moving here was because I knew the political climate. New Mexico is its own little unique area in the whole state, the whole union. Okay, so one of the things we also wanted to know was whether living in one of these immigration immigration policy climates affected people's identification with their state. So this particular table plots a particular probability of people saying that their particular state identity is important. And I'll point you to, for us, what is a sort of confusing finding, but also a kind of interesting finding. So it's actually the U.S. born, if you just kind of look at those people saying that state immigration policy is very important to them. It's the U.S. born in Arizona who say that their state, state identity is the least important to them. And in fact, in a series of findings that you'll see in a second, it's the U.S. born in Arizona who actually feel like they belong the least, at least according to these indicators. And it is the U.S. born in New Mexico who, perhaps not surprisingly, say they feel like they belong the most. Granted, these are very small differences. The one puzzling finding for us is that it's the foreign-born in New Mexico who, at least on this kind of very important aspect of the measure, say that their identity is less important, state identity is less important to them than foreign-born in Arizona. Again, these are really, really minor differences. Looking at a kind of another gauge of state-level belonging, we wanted to know, we asked people the degree to which they feel like they belong in their state. Puzzlingly, again, it's the foreign-born in New Mexico. This does not at all come out in the in-depth interviews who say that they feel like they belong, at least likely to say like they feel like they belong a lot. It is, the U.S.-born in Arizona who actually register sort of a lower level of feelings of like they belong a lot, even compared to the foreign-born in Arizona, which is something that we've seen on the paper. And so we asked people about the level of pride they have in living in their particular state, and once again, the differences between policy and culture emerged, where people in New Mexico, Latinos in New Mexico, felt like they belonged much more or felt like they had more pride in their state because they viewed New Mexico as a generally open state, open to all kinds of differences, including differences by national origin. And Arizona, quite the opposite. But let's start with New Mexico. This is a 19-year-old Mexican immigrant and a DACA recipient. Are all of you familiar with DACA? If you're not, you will be after the next presentation. who talks about the degree to which his own kind of views of New Mexico, and he said, I would describe it as a diverse and beautiful, because that's what makes it beautiful, you know? It's just, there's so many people, the cultures, the views, like, there's a lot to be available. I think that New Mexico is amicable. It's amicable, and I guess it's just welcoming, because like I said, it's just different cultures, different people. New Mexico itself doesn't discriminate. It does not, you know, that's how I feel I would describe New Mexico. Where we do see really stark differences by state on a particular gauge of belonging is when we ask people about the degree to which Latinos are discriminated against in their state. And here, if we look at, again, just queuing in on people who say there's a great deal of discrimination against Latinos, or there are stark differences by state. Once again, it is the U.S. born in Arizona most likely to see discrimination against Latinos, even relative to the foreign born. But the big picture here, I think, is differences by state in which Arizona, but Latinos in Arizona and New Mexico are viewing discrimination. there are kind of two ways to think about discrimination in the state of Arizona. One is sort of perceptions of discrimination, and the survey captures that, and our interviews capture that as well. And the second is actually feeling the discrimination. So one is to perceive it, and one is to actually experience instance of it. So the perceptions were strong and across the board among our U.S. and foreign-born Latino immigrant respondents. This is Christina Suarez. These are pseudonyms, by the way. She's a 26-year-old paralegal, daughter of Mexican immigrants born in the United States. And she talks about particularly the year 2010 when Arizona passed SB 1070, which is a kind of emblematic anti-immigrant law. She said, in 2010, I was 18 years old, so I feel like that's a very transformative age, too. But after, I just felt like there was this feeling, like this dark veil kind of feeling, like in the back of your throat. Everything I did, I just started carrying like this burden for all of my friends and family members that I knew were undocumented. I kind of acquired this worry for them, and it hasn't gone away. Like, it wasn't like where you could just point at something or something and say, that's a bad thing, like a veil. I just felt like very worried and like almost like hopeless. And it's like you're yelling, trying to get your point across, but the person you're yelling at has headphones on. That's how I describe it. You know, or like they're not even looking at you. Like they're ignoring you and they're yelling and you're fighting and you're yelling and you're fighting for your life. A number, particularly of our immigrants, but not just our immigrant Latino respondents, described a kind of pall of anti-immigrant sentiment that hung over the state and that was cast in particular by anti-immigrant policies. But it wasn't just that our respondents perceived discrimination. There were almost every Latino we interviewed had in Arizona had a tale of actually feeling the bite of the administrative aspect of these anti-immigrant policies. And some of the policies are quite aggressive and quite explicitly exclusionary. So you think of Sheriff Joe Arpaio, who until 2017 was the sheriff of Maricopa County, 2017 or 2018, maybe got a, no, 2018. No, it was 2016. It was 2016. He lost in 2016. So 2016, that's right, he ran for Senate in 2018. He was the sheriff of Maricopa County and one of the purveyors of a kind of anti-immigrant policy, not only because purveyors of anti-immigrant sentiment, not only because of the policies that he carried out, but also because he was an out-vocal proponent of really unwelcoming policies. And that's a kind of more aggressive implementation of unwelcoming policies, but there's a more passive way in which anti-immigrant policies exclude. So one of them, and I've mentioned this a couple of times, is the state-level policies regarding higher education. Undocumented immigrants in New Mexico, whether they have DACA, Arizona, whether they have DACA or not, have to pay out-of-state tuition, which, to put things in perspective, in-state tuition in Arizona is actually probably $10,000 a year. Out-of-state tuition, you essentially pay the equivalent of a private university, which is probably in the $30,000 range, $30,000, $35,000 range. So they're excluded from paying, and they have to pay out-of-state tuition. They're also excluded from state aid to pay for college. And that bite for some people, the bite of that policy was real. So this is a DACA recipient who was a construction manager, Nelia Torres, who actually managed to graduate from college eventually and got a fairly good job under DACA because she has a work permit. But talked about what it was like when the provision passed that barred state colleges and universities from providing aid. She said, I think that first year I was at Northern Arizona University, my scholarship got pulled due to a proposition that was put in place there in the state. I was pretty devastated. I really didn't know what I was going to do, what was going to be of me. My whole childhood, all I planned for was going to a university and, you know, getting educated. You know, if you get educated, good things will come. And when that got pulled for me, I remember being at home for the first 2 months. And after a while, I felt like I was starting to lose my mind. I didn't know what to do. I was not just bored out of my mind, but I was lost. I was completely lost. In the interest of time, no, I actually do want to read this. So, once again, when we ask people about levels of discrimination against Latinos in each state, if there was a vague sense that New Mexico was welcoming, that vague sense became more specific when people compared their experiences or what they knew of other people's experiences living in the two states. So this is a quote from Rafael Ortiz, who's a naturalized citizen from Ecuador, and he is a musician who performs in both New Mexico and Arizona, and without our prompting, talked about what it's like coming back from Arizona, where he performs frequently. And he said, although I'm a citizen, when I come back from Arizona, I cross the state border, and it's like, that he's wiping his forehead. I feel like I'm leaving a state that puts pressure. It's just that you never know. You never know what's going to happen. I have heard cases where citizens were stopped, and they put them in detention centers and everything until they see the papers, and oh, sorry, and everything, and let it out. They do not care. That's why I'm leaving Arizona. I'm like, oh, yeah, in English. You say this. It's not like that in New Mexico. I've been here 10 years, and my life is very tranquil. I've never had anything bad happen to me. It's like going home. It's like getting home. I have support from family, from good friends. I think that it's still a peaceful state, and I have not had any bad experience because of an immigration situation, and it's still calm. It's fine. So basically, we've made the case that these are different policy regimes, that these different policy, immigration policy regimes create different levels create different feelings of belonging among the people who live under them, particularly Latinos in this case. I should say that we have somewhat similar findings with whites, except the differences break down by partisanship, and I'll table that for discussion. But recently we've made the correlational case. We said that if you live in Arizona, there are a set of policies that are unwelcoming, and that makes you feel unwelcome. That's not that surprising, perhaps. And in New Mexico, there is mostly welcoming policies, and that makes Latinos feel welcome. And we have tried to make the case that those correlations have, in fact, some causation through interviews, but we went even further and we did experiments to try to get at causality. And then I'll wrap up with this and go very quickly. We primed half of our sample. This is an experiment embedded in our survey. Primed half our sample to think that their state policymakers were going to make things more welcoming for immigrants. And we gave them, meaning the people who conducted our survey for us, read them this welcoming condition. And we tried to give examples of policies in each place, like more social services for non-citizens, providing more government documents in languages other than English, and then allowing residents to get identification cards. We also tend the other half of our sample to think that their state policymakers were going to make things more unwelcoming for immigrants. And we essentially offered them the antonym of these specific welcoming policies. Fewer social services for non-citizens, requiring government documents that are available only in English, and requiring employees to verify the immigration status of their employees. And then we asked them a series of socio-psychological affect questions. We wanted to know whether knowing about the specific policy prompt that they got made them feel happy or sad. Did it make them feel angry or content? And then we put those in a scale. And then we also asked them whether knowing about these policies made them feel more welcome or unwelcome. And here's what we found. So we arrayed this not only by condition. So the dark condition is the hostile condition, and the light bar is the welcoming condition. But we also divided our sample into self-proclaimed political ideology, whether they said they were liberal, moderate, or conservative. And across the board, regardless of political ideology among Latinos, being primed to think that your state policymakers are going to make things more welcoming is associated with more positive aspects. That is, they feel happier and more content. This is among foreign-born Latinos. There's a similar pattern among the U.S.-born Latinos, although not quite as prominent among the self-proclaimed conservatives. And then we also asked about belonging, whether these policies would make them feel like they belong more or less. And you see a very similar pattern, although more muted difference among conservatives. I just want to highlight here in closing that you actually see the exact same pattern among U.S.-born whites, except among the conservatives. So this the upshot, and if there's a political, if not policy, implication, it's that more welcoming immigration policies not only make Latinos across the board feel more welcome, which is perhaps not surprising, but it actually makes white people feel more welcome and feel like they belong more in their state, with the exception of self-proclaimed conservatives. The conservative aspect of it is perhaps, I can even show you this if you're interested, is perhaps not surprising, except that there's really no good reason to think that whites should feel like they benefit anyway from policies that are more welcoming or unwelcoming. And I should note that among liberals, I mean, this difference is almost near the foreign-born Latinos in our sample. We can talk in the Q&A, because I've gone on way too long, about why this might be, given kind of, and Lisa could probably help us weigh in here on the kind of nature of partisan politics and its alignment with particular attitudes on immigration. But I'll stop there. Thanks for your attention. Thanks for letting me kind of fumble through this again.